The upcoming offerings for games on PlayStation look pretty promising, including Ghost of Tsushima, Dead Stranding, Last of Us Part 2, and a whole other slew of other games, including Days Gone as well in April. And while the game offering looks pretty nice in terms of PlayStation in the future, what about other topics, including Battle Royale games, the streaming future of gaming, the E3 2019 debacle of them not being there, as well as the communication void that they will have to fill by not having E3 in their line of plans? Well, lucky for us, the big homie Shawn Layden sat down with CNET and did a full-on interview talking about all these different topics, and of course I will have that article linked at the top of the description. What's going on, guys? It is your boy TKD123 here, and today we're going over all of these different topics that do shine a good light on PlayStation as well as some negative. And of course, stay tuned for tomorrow's save slot, where we have a lot more things to talk about in terms of a very, very spicy topic that was brought up here on this interview that I will leave out in this video just because I feel like it's more better for save slot. But let's get right into it. And before we get started on the whole Shawn Layden interview, all that breakdown and everything that we have for us today, you'll be watching some Devil May Cry 5 demo gameplay from last weekend. I'm not sure if it's still up. It might be. I'm not 100% sure. But you're watching some Devil May Cry 5 demo from the PS4 Pro that I captured. So hope you all enjoy that, and on to the video. So like I said, there's going to be four big topics that we'll discuss here. And the first one here I'm going to bring up is how Shawn Layden views streaming. Okay, so the question that I first want to hit on was, how does Shawn Layden view streaming in the future of PlayStation in terms of upcoming different hardware that they will be releasing? And so they bring up different examples of streaming, like with Ubisoft and Google, how you could stream AC Odyssey. They bring up that EA has one to announce. Amazon is doing something as well. Apple as well in this whole ecosystem. So there's a ton of different players that play here in terms of streaming that will be coming to the forefront of gaming. And so Shawn Layden, you know, basically said that, you know, it's affirmation that gaming's here to stay. It's growing dramatically, and it's growing into a much broader entertainment landscape with big players coming in. Like you mentioned, they'll bring new energy and stimulus and agitation, which I definitely agree. I think streaming is something that will be much bigger in the future, and it's definitely here to stay. But then he mentioned, you know, this interviewer from CNET states that he does indeed have PlayStation Now, but not sure if he would play a shooting game on it and doesn't feel ready to replace my console with a full streaming service. And so he says it's definitely a thing. The challenge on streaming is that while it may get to a place reasonably quick that folks who live on a top of a good node in Soma or Sal or Stockholm can get a good streaming life, if you're PlayStation and you're available in 168 countries around the world, streaming will be a thing which will have interest to certain people in certain places. But still, for the vast majority of the gaming community, our 94 million PS4s are out there. I think there's much left in a local console. And so I think that is something that be said immensely true, is that, you know, although there are tons of different PS4s out in the wild, not everyone has the same internet across the entire world. And so honestly, if they release a console that doesn't have a disc drive or any physical, you know, game support, that will be very detrimental for a lot of gamers that do not have the capability to stream games. And he even says that here, and kind of, you know, hits that point home. If the PlayStation continues to grow at this rate, we can leave no gamer behind. But streaming is something that PlayStation is active in, and we want to make sure we keep current in that technology. So it looks like they're going to be playing that two-lane role where they will be supporting streaming, and of course we'll also support that local game, the really traditional way of gameplay, where of course you download that game or you have a physical copy of it, etc. And so me, although I use PS Now actually a lot now, really, after I used it last year, I definitely am still a subscriber of PS Now. I still use it a ton. I think it's a great service and really does work for me, but that is because I have pretty good internet. I have 100 out of 100 down, really low ping. I have pretty good internet here in Arizona, but of course I am not everyone. And so I really do like how at least Sony here and PlayStation are going to be supporting both facets of gaming, the traditional way and also streaming in the future. And it does sound a lot like what Xbox is doing as well, where they're rumored to be doing a Xbox that is only streaming, that's cheaper. And they have a regular Xbox that will, of course, probably have a Blu-ray drive, etc. And the next topic here is, of course, the big elephant in the room in terms of the gaming industry, and that is, of course, Battle Royale. It's a big craze, of course. We all know about Fortnite. Apex Legends is killing it right now, as of recently. And he was asked about this question, and with Battle Royale games becoming so popular, how do they decide what types of games to make? Whether it's creating a direct competitor or a Me Too type game or something different, you know? And so Shawn Layden says, quote, "I don't want to get into Me Too. I think the world's got all the battle royale it needs right now. I think we've done a lot over the last 3 or 4 years to get us to a place right now where we're building fewer games per year than ever before, but we're spending more time, more energy, certainly more money on making them. So we're striking on all those beats that we want to. We're creating both critical and commercial acclaim. Let's see now what we might add to our arsenal. I've looked at some opportunities in the past. It's an opportunity to look for the ones that are the best cultural fit. And this is probably one of the best answers he's given in terms of this topic. It's because, you know, I honestly agree. Like, I do have the opinion, of course, and I've spoken on this channel a lot about it in terms of PlayStation games, and that is that I wish PlayStation exclusives were more multiplayer centric. Not all of them, but I wish there were a few games in the exclusive offering that had really, really great crafted multiplayer modes like Last of Us 1 Factions. Of course, again, let me just reiterate before I see in the comment sections, I am not saying every PlayStation exclusive needs a tactile multiplayer. I'm saying if there is a development mode that is developed in-house that is a great multiplayer crafted mode, that should be on the exclusive. Why not? You know, why not let it fly? That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying every single exclusive needs some crazy tacked on, you know, lackluster multiplayer mode. I'm saying let's make really, really good ones, because I feel like we've had a lack of them in terms of PlayStation exclusives this generation. But beside the point, you know, I definitely am kind of hesitant on them bringing a battle royale into this, even though if y'all look in your seats, I know I said it. I know I made a video about Last of Us Battle Royale. I understand that. Although that was a really, really good concept. I think it had a really good frame structure for that game mode. But beside the point, you know, I do subscribe to the theory that I think PlayStation should do a little bit better in terms of multiplayer on their exclusives, and I definitely would not want to see every game get battle royale mode. However, I would like to see every game get a really cool multiplayer mode. But he does comment on something in the last year that of course, you know, to just you know, double back on the main topic, I really do agree with him saying that, you know, let's not put out a lot, let's put out really, really good fewer games, and let's kind of cultivate these games and make them good, make them have a lot of, you know, just great reception and everything, and just take a lot of care of our exclusives. I really do enjoy hearing that from him. But also, he has this little philosophy that I think speaks volumes to really how they cultivate their exclusives. He has this whole mantra of first, best, or must. He says that if your title is going to be the first in creating a genre, or first in creating a new game activity, let's look at that. If you're going to make an action adventure game, it better be best in class. And we have the third category called must, which is we must support the platform we must present when new technology comes out. So that speaks volumes, really does give a lot of context to how we've seen these exclusives pump out in the PS4 era with bangers like, of course, God of War, Horizon Zero Dawn, Marvel Spider-Man. Like, there are a ton of examples of them using this straight up, you know what I'm saying? And it's really, really great to see that they have this in there, and it really does bring a lot of context to there. So long story short, I do really like how they are not going to be Me Tooing a battle royale or maybe having a tagged on, but I do still hope that in the future we have a really, really cool crafted multiplayer modes in some of the PS exclusives that warrant a multiplayer mode. Next up here, he discusses a really, really big topic that of course was a huge thing that came out in 2018, and that was of course PlayStation's absence in E3 2019. And so they will not be there at E3, of course, and he kind of gave some context and really did a lot of back explaining before explaining his main answer. So I'm gonna just graze through and kind of just do a nice little recap of what he was saying. So he was saying that back when they decided to take video games out of CES back in 95, it was because they wanted to serve the retailers and journalists in a way better way. And so they went to E3, where there were those two groups of people. There were retailers and journalists. And so back then, he explains that retailers would be educated by them by explaining what video games are and how to market them and how to retail them in their stores. And then journalists would, of course, be jockeying for good positions on covers. And that there was no mention of the internet. And so that is what was a trade show. It was where you had retailers and journalists come to see games, and the retailers got educated on those games to be able to sell in their stores. And then journalists were trying to get the news out of the gaming community via their newspapers and publications, etc. Then he brings up that for retailers, they have a specific event called Destination PlayStation, where they bring a lot of retailers together and third-party partners to come and hear their kind of plan for the year in terms of retail. So they already have that in stock. But then they said that, you know, since retail has dropped off and journalists now are on the internet and they have a 24/7 news cycle of gaming news and everything, the overall culmination of having a trade show like E3 to bring everyone around just has lost its impact because of those two things. And so that's where we get into his direct quote. He says, "The world has changed, but E3 hasn't necessarily changed with it. And with our decision to do fewer games, bigger games over longer periods of time, we got to a point where June of 2019 was not a time for us to have anything new to say. And we feel like if we ring the bell and people show up in here in force, people have expectations, oh, they're going to tell us something. We are progressing the conversation about how do we transform E3 to be more relevant? Can E3 transition more into a fan festival of gaming, where we don't gather there to drop the new bomb? Can it just be a celebration of games and have panels where we bring game developers closer to fans?" And so right there, I feel like he's explaining exactly what PSX was, that I think it was 2017, I believe. Yes, 2017, where they essentially had a bunch of panels and there wasn't really a lot of news and everything and all that. And so that was definitely what he was describing there as that vision of what he wants. And to me, that definitely sounds a lot like PAX. I feel like we already have that necessarily in the industry, but it's just really interesting to see that, you know, he essentially said that, you know, there was a point of June 2019 where they knew that they would not have anything new to show, which is very, I'm not going to say alarming. I'm not going to say really upsetting per se, just because we know what is coming. Like, we know what is going to come. We know Last of Us Part 2 is coming out. We know Death Stranding, Ghost of Tsushima, Days Gone is out in April. We know a ton of these games already that are coming out. So me personally, I'm not really scared at all about it, but I know this might be a little bit alarming to a lot of people, saying that like they really didn't have anything to show. But you know, I have faith. It's all good. You know what I'm saying? It is what it is. But let's go on to the last topic that actually has a lot to do with communication. And so with Shawn Layden laying out that he feels that for E3 to maintain relevance, that they will need to kind of shift its trajectory towards a more celebration of games and more panel-based type of you know, events that they have every year and stuff like that, similar to PSX or PAX, etc. And so then the interviewer at CNET asked him, so what happens to big announcements? Do they just happen on YouTube? What does the perfect Shawn Layden future look like? And I do not like this answer. I'm gonna keep it 100% with you guys. I do not enjoy his answer. You know me, I love PlayStation, I love Shawn Layden, what he has to say 99% of the time, but this right here is not something that I really enjoyed hearing. But there is some things that maybe he might be hiding, but beside the point. He says, in a perfect Shawn Layden future, I'm living in Tahiti. Now, I get that, you know, he represents the brand of PlayStation in this interview. I understand that. And of course, I understand that there are a lot of different other moving pieces in terms of their plans for 2019. I totally get that, right? But to brush it off like this, you know, it kind of rubbed me a little bit the wrong way. Now, again, to play devil's advocate, I 100% understand that, of course, they have something planned for this year. I think that they will not go 2019 without having some sort of big event, some sort of presence in the global standpoint of the standpoint of the gaming industry and everything. I feel like they definitely will say something like a announcement, of course, this year, because, like, come on, like, they can't go 2019 without having one announcement at all. Like, come on now, you know. And so where that happens, I don't know. And I think that he really dodged his question because he wants to keep that under wrap. You know what I'm saying? Like, maybe it is the PlayStation 5 reveal event. I don't know. Maybe it is. Maybe it's something else. Maybe they want to keep it under wraps and let them announce the events on their own accord, on their own stage, and not seeing that interview. So I definitely understand that. But, you know, that question just kind of rubbed me the wrong way. And I hope to see what happens next. Because is there going to be PSX this year? We don't know. Is there going to be a whole dedicated another show that they have? Are they going to do something around E3? I know they said that they wouldn't do anything around E3, but maybe somewhere in that same season. Who knows? But I guess we'll have to wait and see what 2019 has in store. And ladies and gentlemen, that has been the whole breakdown. Well, not the whole breakdown. We have one more piece of this whole puzzle that will be on Save Slot tomorrow. I just had to put it on there because it is too juicy to have by itself. I need to talk about that crossplay because there is some smoke here that Shawn Layden spewed that a lot of devs are attacking him for, but we are going to talk about that tomorrow on safe slot. But that's my video for today, guys. If you all enjoyed, make sure to leave a like on the video as well as subscribe to PlayStation Shorts to keep up with the latest and greatest in PlayStation. And make sure to also check out our description below where you can find our Twitch, our Twitter, all the good stuff down below, as well as our Discord server. Make sure to go join that Discord. We're all talking in there. A lot of good things happen in there. You know what I'm saying? We're playing games, all the good stuff. Make sure to go join that Discord server down below in the description. Thank you for watching. And as always, greatness awaits.